Welcome all. Today we are focused on the poem Full Fathom 5, Thy Father Lies by William Shakespeare. As usual, our journey starts with the introduction of the author. Shakespeare lived from 1564 to 1616. He was born in a market town 91 miles northwest of London named Stratford. He moved to London after his marriage sometime in between 1585 to 1592. In London, Shakespeare enjoyed a successful career as a poet, playwright, and actor. He was also the part owner of the playing company named Lord Chamberlain's Men. In his career, Shakespeare wrote about some 39 plays, 154 sonnets, few long narrative poems, and other verses. In around 1613, aged 49, Shakespeare took a retirement and returned back to his birthplace. There, 3 years later, Shakespeare passed away, aged 52. Before writing tragedies like Macbeth and Hamlet, Shakespeare for many years wrote historical plays and comedies. His characters, especially heroes in his tragedies, are very successful to get the sympathy, attention, in spite of their terrible deeds. Shakespeare brought the lyrical element to play. He mostly wrote in blank verse, that is, 10 syllables each line, where unstressed syllables are followed by stressed syllables and are unrhymed. This style is suitable for long narrative poems and drama. Shakespeare is considered one of the greatest dramatists of all time. He is one of the most influential writer of English. This is all that we need to know about the author. After the introduction of the author, we need to have the knowledge of sound significance in poetry to decode the given poem. Now, what is that? Poetry as a genre of literature is distinct from the genres like essay and fiction because of the musical quality. At the heart of this genre remains musicality. Whenever we encounter this word poem or poetry, what comes to our mind is rhythm, rhyme, the harmony of sounds, the sonorous property of the text. You label some utterance to be poetic when the utterance is with the harmony of sounds. It is sonorous. If it has some rhythm in it, if it has some rhyme in it, then we label that piece to be poetic. Poetry is a special combination of literary and musical elements. That is, poetry does not simply present the images with the help of metaphors, symbols, or the words. What poetry does is, poetry presents the idea in the most sonorous configuration possible, in the most harmonious, rhythmatic way possible. So to address this musical property of poetry, poets use various different sound devices, and these sound devices create the musicality in poetry. Not only the musicality is created through the sounds, but also the sounds in poetry contribute to the meaning, theme of the poetry. Now, what are the sound devices that poets use? One of the sound device is a rhyme. This is about repetition of similar sounding words in poetry. For example, I am running down the road trying to loosen down my load. Here, two similar sounding words are used at the end of the lines, road and load. This use of similar sounding words at the end of two lines is giving the musical property to the poetry. So this is one of the devices. Poets not only repeat the similar sounding words in poetry, for the sound effect. They also repeat the letter or the combination of letters in words near to each other in a line. For example, mummy is a common dummy. Here we see mummy comes with 2M, common comes with 2M, dummy comes with WM. Now this use, repetition of WM, is also creating the musicality in poetry. Now when the repetition is made of the consonants, like in mummy is a common dummy in Egypt, here the repetition is of the consonant sound. So when the repetition is made of the consonant sounds in words near to each other, we call it consonance. And when the same consonant is repeated only at the beginning of the words near each other, like in our poetry, Fool, Fathom Five, Thy Father Lies, here we see the repetition of consonant sound F at the beginning of the words near each other. Fool starts with F, Fathom starts with F, Five starts with F, Father starts with F. So when the repetition of the consonant sound is made, but at the beginning of the words near each other, we call it alliteration. So repetition of consonant in between the words, that is consonants. Repetition of consonant sounds at the beginning of the words near each other, we call it alliteration. And when the repetition is made of the vowels, like light my fire, here I is repeated, light, L-I, F-I, R-E, fire. So here the repetition is of vowels. So when the repetition is made of the vowels in words near to each other in a line, we call it assonance. After the repetition of letters and similar sounding words, the other sound device at poet's disposal is onomatopoeic words. Now, what is this? Onomatopoeia are those words, are the words formed from a sound with what it is named. The sound of these words are similar to the actual audition the sound is trying to denote. For example, mew, M-E-O-W. The pronunciation of word mew is very similar to the actual sound. So these type of words which try to imitate, resemble the sound it is denoting, we call it onomatopoeic words. For example, mew, boom, bang, click, these are all the words which have the same pronunciation as the real audition. With these words, poet evoking the auditory perception tries to give us the impression of what something sounds like. For example, in our poetry, ding dong bell. This ding dong, this word is onomatopoeic word, because ding dong, the sound is similar to the pronunciation of the words. So these type of sounds gives us the impression of what something sounds like. These are few devices that we need to know to decode the poetry. Now, getting down to the poetry, what we discover is our poetry is taken from the play, The Tempest. Now, what happens in the play? In the play, we have two brothers, Prospero and Antonio. Prospero is the Duke of Milan, and Antonio is the most trusted brother who takes care of all the governance. Now, Antonio conspires against his own brother, Prospero, in want to be the king himself. Antonio exiles his brother Prospero along with his daughter Miranda. They are casted to a deserted island. And at the time, Alonso is the king of Naples, and this king does nothing in favor of Prospero. This island where these two are casted is a magical island where witch Sycorax dwelt some time ago, and this dead witch has imprisoned some spirits there in the island. Prospero with his magic frees the spirit Ariel, and many years later, ships carrying King Alonso, his son Ferdinand, Antonio, and other members of the royal court comes near the island. Prospero is aware about this voyage and raises the tempest, brings the sea storm with his magic added by Ariel. Now he brings the violent sea storm, and in the shipwreck caused by this storm, Ferdinand, to save his life, jumps off the deck into the blue water. Ariel, the invisible spirit, saves Ferdinand, and as ordered by Prospero to lure Ferdinand ashore, this invisible spirit starts singing a song. He sings two songs, and the second song that spirit sings to Ferdinand is our poetry. His father hasn't died, but Ferdinand assumes that his father has died in the shipwreck, and to provide the solace, to console the grieving soul, Ariel sings the second song, redefining death. Now, what Ariel says, let's find out from the poetry. The poetry goes, "Full fathom five thy father lies, of his bones are coral made. Those are pearls that were his eyes, nothing of him that doth fade, but doth suffer a sea of change into something rich and strange. Sea nymphs hourly ring his bell, ding dong, hark, now I hear them, ding dong bell." Fathom is a unit of measurement. 1 fathom equals to 6 feet. So 5 fathom means 30 feet. Now, what is Ariel saying? Ariel in the poetry is redefining the death. Ferdinand thinks his father has drowned during the shipwreck, and Ferdinand is mourning. Ariel at the moment sings this song to console the grieving heart, to provide solace to the grief-stricken heart. And here in the song, Ariel redefines death. What Ariel says is, your father is not dead. He is lying 30 feet below this blue water, and there his bones have turned into coral. They have transformed into corals, and his eyes have transformed into pearls. Nothing of his body has vanished from this existence. Nothing of his body has faded away into the thin air. Rather, everything is there. They just went through the process of change. He says, nothing of him that doth fade, but doth suffer a sea of change. Nothing has vanished. No organ, no part of his body has vanished and faded away from this entity. Nothing is lost from this entity. Nothing of his body is lost from this entity. But your father has gone through the transformation, gone through the change, where his body changed from one form to another form. He hasn't vanished, but only have gone through the change, gone through the process of transformation. And this transformation is into something rich and valuable. than the previous state. This transformation of your father is making your father more valuable and longer lasting. This transformation is not ruining, not destroying your father, is not deteriorating, decaying him. Rather, this change is taking your father into the greater realm, into something rich and strange. So this transformation, this change of his body is not into something below the previous status. Rather, the entities your father had changed into are more valuable and longer lasting. After that, what Ariel says is, listen, your father is welcomed there. Your father is enjoying there. See, nymphs are ringing hourly bells to your father. Your father is not dejected there. Your father is rather in a soothing place where he is provided the solace by the sea nymphs. So he is not in a void. Your father has not been into the void where there is nothing and darkness. Rather, your father is welcomed there underground. Your father is being treated well. Your father is being entertained by these sea nymphs who hourly ring the bell for his pleasure and for his entertainment. Listen carefully. You hear the bell, ding dong bell. Listen carefully, Ferdinand. You hear the bell. This is what Ariel says to Ferdinand through this song. What Ariel says is, your father is lying 30 feet below this water, and there his bones have transformed into corals. His eyes have transformed into pearls. Your father has not just vanished from this existence. Rather, your father went through the change and he changed into something rich, strange, more valuable than the state he was in before. And there where your father went, in that world, your father is not sad, dejected, depressed, in the void, dark. Rather, see nymphs ring the bell to provide pleasure to your father, to entertain him, and there he is not in a state of dilapidation. Rather, he is in a good state where he is enjoying. Listen carefully, you can hear those bells, ding dong bell. This is what Ariel says. Now, what does this mean? This means that death is not the end of the life. Rather, it is the beginning of something new. For example, for the tree to come out, seed vanishes. Now, this loss of seed in the process of becoming a tree is not the death of the seed. Rather, seed has transformed into something valuable, something rich, and this is what happens to everyone. We think it to be the death, but it is not the death. Rather, it is the beginning of something new. Once I read a story in social networking site. That story was about the twins in the womb. The twins in the womb are talking to each other. The first one says, "Hey, second one, can you feel? There's mother all around us. And one day when we get out of this world, we will get a chance to see our mother. There we will eat from our mouth, breathe from the nostrils. There will be light and glow. Our eyes will see everything." This is what the first twin says to the second one. And the second says, "Ha, what a bullshit. This is our world. There is no such thing called mother. And after this world, there is nothing. It's all death. After this world, there is nothing. This is the world. This amniotic fluid we are floating in is our world. And beside this, there is no any other world. What a bullshit. Are you in illusion? What are you talking about? You'll eat from your mouth. How will you eat from your mouth? We'll eat from the umbilical cord and breathe from the nostrils. Lie. What are those? They are just your fancy. It's your imagination. This is what the second twin says. Here in this case, what we see is definitely there is a death for the womb. These twins have to die for the womb. They have to die for the womb. But here nothing stops. Rather, they will definitely progress, come into the world, breathe from the nostrils, eat from the mouth, see their mother, hug her, embarrass her. And this is going to happen to them. But they are unaware in this world. They think that this is the world. The second twin is unaware about these happenings. He is saying this is the world. Here is what we have, and after this there is nothing. So is the status of Ferdinand. Ferdinand is saying, my father is dead, he is no more in this world. But Ariel is saying, come on, death is not like that what you have perceived. Death is something else. It is the transformation. Like a caterpillar goes inside the cocoon and comes out with the wings as a butterfly. Now that caterpillar has not died in the process of metamorphosis. Rather, it has transferred from one form to another form. So is the case here. Ariel is saying death is not the end. Rather, death is about the transformation. Now here Ariel redefines death as something valuable and as something which is not the end, full stop. Rather, is the beginning of something else. Now this poetry is in the unit of ecology and change. Now what does that mean? In nature, in this ecosystem, nothing fades, nothing dies, nothing vanishes. Rather, everything changes from one form to another form. There is a law regarding the conservation of energy. So we call it the law of conservation of energy. This law states that energy can neither be created nor can be destroyed. Rather, can be transferred from one form to another form. So what we see here is things change from one form to another form, but they never fade away from the existence. They remain in this existence in various different forms. Like if I die, my body will decay and this body will turn into soil. That soil into a tree and into animal and maybe someday God. So this is the process of change that nature comes with. In nature, everything is dynamic. Everything has to go under these changes. Now, if we take the example of river and water, what we see is ice melts, turns into water. Water evaporates, turns into vapor. Vapor condenses and again turns into water. Here, for a moment being, when ice is melted, what we see is we see the loss of ice. But is there the actual loss, or ice has just transferred from one form to another form? It has just transferred from one form to another form. When we see this water changing into the vapor, we feel the water is no more there. The water is lost. It has faded away from the entity. But in reality, it hasn't faded away. It has only changed its form from liquid state to gaseous state. So on, trees fall, they decay, and these decaying trees turn into soil and a new tree again. So now this is the process of the nature. In ecosystem, nothing is wasted. Everything goes in this circle of change. In Hindu philosophy too, what we see is Hindus have this belief of 8,400,000 births. Now, what is this? This is the change that we experience. This is the change that we have to go through, the sea of change, the varying arrays of change that one entity passes in this ecosystem, one entity have to go through in this ecosystem. So this poetry can be interpreted from the perspective of ecological criticism. That is, in ecosystem, nothing is wasted and destroyed. We take it as the destruction, but it is not the destruction. It is the transformation from one form, from the shape of one entity into the shape of other entity, into the shape of other things. So on, what am I? I am the combination of hydrogen, carbon and oxygen. When these elements dismantle, I dismantle. So these elements really never fade. They remain in this entity in various different ways. And when they combine, I am here. And when they dismantle, I am lost. So actually, at the moment when they dismantle, I am not lost. Rather, I am changed into those particles. We breathe, we live with the breathe, right? Once the breathe is gone, it doesn't mean my soul is lost. That breathe is all around us, that air is all around us. So in ecosystem, nothing fades away, nothing is lost. Everything goes under the change. And this change is portrayed through this poetry. This change is prominent through our life also. From the sperm and egg, we turned into a zygote, and that zygote turned into a creature like me. So here too, we see sperm fades away, egg fades away, zygote fades away and gives way to the person like me. So here we cannot say it is the death of the sperm, it is the death of the seed. It is actually the transformation. This process of change under which every element of the entity have to go is being realized in the poem. Now, how is the play of sound contributing to the theme of the poetry? Let's find it out. First, what we discover is the use of alliteration. That is the repetition of consonant sound as the initial letter of the words near each other. Full, fathom, five, thy father lies, fa, 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 fa. What is this doing? This sound is actually creating, resembling the flow of water. And this flow of water is indicating a dynamic nature, is indicating a nature that does not stay static, constant, rather keeps on changing, like the water flowing from one point to another point. Water is in a journey. So on, the elements of this world, either it be the living elements or the non-living elements, it be the biotic element or abiotic element, they all are in this process of change. They do not remain constant, they are dynamic. Constantly they shift from one point to another point. And this change, this flow is portrayed through the sound. F, 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 F. This is trying to imitate the flow. What our poet is saying us is everything in this universe definitely have to go under this chains. This have to be followed. And here poet is creating the flow, indicating the change with the repetition of word F. And the same sound also contributes to indicate the sinister nature. Like, nobody wants to go under the chains. Seed wants to remain a seed. I want to remain here in this world. So on, everybody wants to be in their state, but they cannot remain in their state forever. They are forced to change their state. They have to go through the chains. They have to transform in spite of their desire to remain unchanged and static. So this is the sinister nature of the entity, that everything have to go under chains though they wanted to remain static. And this sinister intention of change is also portrayed through this alliteration, through the repetition of word F. Next, what we see is the use of onomatopoeic words like ding dong bell, ding dong. These words are actually trying to imitate the sound they are denoting. And now these words use the plosive sound here. Plosive are the sounds like da, ba, which comes with the explosion of air. Now, why is poet using these plosive sounds in onomatopoeic words? Plosive sounds, though there is no fixed rule for the sound symbolism, it depends upon the poetry as a whole, and these rules are not fixed. Still, there are some rules of thumb. And here in the poetry, plosive sound is used to talk about the harsh reality, of chains that is banging on each door. So this is the chains. If we listen carefully, this time has not only approached Ferdinand's father, rather it is for him to, for us to, for everyone. So this reality, inevitable and omnipresent, is being indicated through the plosive sounds. And these onomatopoeic sounds are giving us the sensation that these bells of time, death, is always there ringing in our ears. Now, this is all about the poetry. Thank you.